Hello, this is Steve Moniz. I'm here with two cameramen today. We have Mark Allison and Brian Moniz, no relation to this Steve Moniz, although he does have a good name. And we're getting ready to do an episode for our public safety show. It's been a while since we've been here at the fire department, and what we'd like to do to get things rolling is speak to our chief, Scott Jepson, and then maybe go into or have the deputy chief come out to us and ask him a few questions about his new position, because we haven't been here since he has been promoted to deputy chief, and how he's settling in to his new position and his new responsibilities and all the duties that go along with that. We're also hoping to get a demonstration of a new piece of equipment that is installed in one of our rescues dealing with the stretcher. It makes for a safe environment for both the firemen, paramedics that respond to calls, as well as the patient that they may be transporting to the hospital. And as always, if and when the tones do go off, thanks to our chief, we've been allowed to ride along with the men of our fire department and see, in fact, what they do once they get to a call, whether it be a fire, a medical emergency, or anything that may fall under the realm of a response for the fire department. So here with me this morning is our Fire Chief Scott Jepson. Thank you very much, Chief, for allowing us to come into the firehouse once again.
Glad to have you.
To have, you know, a transparency that the public can see what's going on in the fire department.
Absolutely, love it.
I know we have had many responses to our public safety shows, and they absolutely love when we come to the fire department. I love when I come to the fire department. The guys, the men and women here are great, and you and the deputy chief do a fantastic job, and I continuously praise the fire department. I always say whenever I'm on at the selectmen's meeting, we are the best in the area, and I truly, truly stand by that comment.
Thank you. I agree.
So what I'd like to ask you, Chief, is if you could, we've recently hired four new firemen slash paramedics with the SAFER grant.
Correct.
And the selectmen approved that, and town meeting cast the final vote for the approval. People may not be aware if they don't watch the town meeting or if they don't watch or come to a weekly selectmen's meeting. Could you kind of go over a little bit about the safety grant and any cost savings that the town has witnessed because of the addition of the four firefighters, if you could?
Yep. So back in October of last year, we got approval from the board to apply for the grant. We were successful, one of only 300 grants throughout the country that were awarded. Very fortunate that we were able to hire four new firefighter paramedics with this grant. It was a $1.15 million grant, of which $753,000 will be awarded to us directly from FEMA. And it allows us to hire these four firefighter paramedics for the next 3 years. The federal government pays 75% of their salary and benefits for the first 2 years and 35% for the third year. After that's up, then it's up to the town whether they absorb those new positions into the department, whether they not fill them through attrition, et cetera. We'll decide that at the time, and you know, we'll see whether it's fiscally responsible mm-hmm. to continue with the positions, which I think it will be. During the 3 years, there is we're not allowed to not fill any positions. So if somebody retires in the 3 years, we have to replace that position, or we will forfeit the grant.
Let me stop you right there, Chief, since that you hit on that. We understand that, and we hope the public understands that as well. However, in the event, as we come up to the third year with the SAFER grant and we get to a decision that we have to make, as you just mentioned, if then someone does retire, can we fill that position with a firefighter that we hired through the SAFER grant?
Yes, that would be the way we do it. So if somebody would retire, we wouldn't actually hire anybody, but we would absorb that SAFER grant position into our normal staffing. So we've been very fortunate that we were awarded this grant. I can tell you that it has already paid for its first year. With the reduction in overtime that we're seeing and the increased amount of ambulance calls that we're able to capture without relying on mutual aid, will more than pay for the first year. It's successful, is exactly how the grant is designed to work. We have an extra firefighter on each shift, and it may not sound like much, but the difference between seven and eight firefighters on a shift is huge. It's one extra person at a fire, which is what the grant, you know, is mainly mm-hmm. about. But obviously, you know, with EMS being 85-80% of our calls, having that extra person on a rescue and staffing that second rescue almost all the time now, which we were not able to do before without significant overtime. You know, it's the calls that, you know, weekends and, you know, 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock in the morning that we have back-to-back calls that, you know, previously we just didn't have the staffing with somebody on vacation or somebody out sick. Those are the calls we're really capturing now and not relying on mutual aid. Our mutual aid coming into town is way down because of these extra positions.
Now, are we capturing any monies from the mutual aid that we respond to surrounding communities for? In other words, where we are called upon for the mutual aid to go into a community? Is that also the case?
Absolutely. So just like, you know, being able to capture more calls in town, we have a second rescue available more often for mutual aid for whether Fall River calls us or Swansea or Dighton. Our mutual aid out is a little bit increased as well.
Now, I'm not sure if folks understand the concept of how the communities get paid for mutual aid, and I know you've explained it in the past at our meetings, but just to recap it, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, and I'll let you elaborate a little more. When we request mutual aid, whoever the responding department is receives the money associated with that call, correct? And on the flip side of that, if we're requested for mutual aid and we go into a community, we're the beneficiaries of the money associated with that call. Is that basically
correct? That is correct. So whichever rescue is doing the transport is who is billing for the call and getting paid. So yes, if we go to Fall River, we will bill, you know, the patient's insurance like we do for a call in town here, and we get that revenue.
So it's definitely paid for itself.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I know I mentioned this, I think, at one of the meetings. It's going to be a tough decision for whoever may be sitting in those seats on the Board of Selectmen to make in the next couple of years, because time just flies right by, and before you know it,
yeah.
Whoever may be sitting, hopefully it'll still be me, I'm not quite sure yet. They'll have a tough decision to make, you know, and yeah. You're a guy that's all about the money and the figures, and I respect you for that. And I'm sure you'll have a spreadsheet or something to show the board, whoever they may be, that this is the right way to go or this is not the right way to go with regard to whichever decision you may be leaning toward.
Yep. You know, so the first 2 years, I don't anticipate, you know, any issues that we're going to more than pay for itself because we're only paying for 25%. Once we get to the third year where we're going to be paying 65%, that's when we're really going to have to crunch the numbers to see if it makes sense or not.
Correct.
So that'll be the test. But
The first couple of years is kind of like, I don't want to say a free ride, but it's almost like a freebie because we're making the money that we were losing, and yet we're not paying that much for the firemen that we've hired, which is a great thing.
Right. They're starting at a lower salary than, you know, senior firefighters as well,
correct.
So there's a savings there.
Correct. And I appreciate you going over that again, because there's some doubt still, I think, in the minds of some that live in town about the additional 4 firefighters that we have.
I understand that. The financial situation we're in, you know, you see somebody hiring and it doesn't make sense unless they're educated about why we did the hiring, which is exactly what we just talked about, where they're paying for themselves.
Right. And, you know, that's why I like to come into the fire department, police department, wherever, whenever I have the opportunity, so that we can have a one-on-one and kind of discuss these issues so people can better understand what is involved. I mean, I know you do a great job when you come to our meetings, but you only have a snippet of time because we have such a long agenda at times. And you try the best to explain it to the general public, but sometimes I don't think some of their questions are answered because of the short amount of time that you have. And that's not any fault of your own. It's because of the agenda items that are on that particular meeting.
Sure. We want the public to be educated. We want them to know why we do things the way we do. I'm all for that. I'm happy to have the public.
I applaud you for that. And, you know, it's when people stop me in town and they question something to do in regards with the fire department, I explain to them the best that I can, because I'm the kind of person that ask you first, or the men that work on the line, to get the information to relay to them. If not, I direct them right here. And as you said in the past, it's their fire department, it's their firehouse.
Yep.
So I applaud you for that again. I know that tomorrow is the implosion of the towers. And I know that when people have the opportunity to see this episode, the towers will be gone already. But I'd like to get your insight on the implosion of the three stacks that took place. I think it was like the beginning of this month, the end of the, I don't recall the date specifically. Your thoughts on that process and what you anticipate for the towers. I don't want to speak tremendously about the towers because, again, they'll be down before this is aired. So if you could touch on that a little bit, please.
Sure. So, you know, the deputy chief specifically has been working with the demolition company for months, along with the property owners. This is not something that just happens overnight. They're required to be permitted and licensed by the ATF, by the Department of Fire Services of Massachusetts, and by the Somerset Fire Department. So the deputy's been, you know, working on the plan with them and all their permits, et cetera, for several months. Been very smooth. The demolition company and the owners of the property have been very good to work with. They're very cooperative. They understand that the safety, obviously, is a priority. You know, it's business, but, you know, the public can have effects from this, which they try to minimize as best they can. I want to say the day of the chimneys was, in my opinion, was flawless. There were no delays, there were no hitches, all the explosives went off that were supposed to. There was no danger to the public. Yes, there was a small amount of dust cloud that did go towards the Point neighborhood, but it dissipated very quickly. You know, again, they do everything they can to minimize that impact, but you just can't eliminate it completely. It's just not possible.
Correct.
But again, the owners of the property and the demolition company have been very, you know, transparent as well, trying to get the information out to the public, trying to, you know, ease their concerns of, you know, catastrophic things happening, which they didn't. So for our part, you know, we were at the command post during the implosions of the chimneys, which, you know, right there at the property. We had an engine and ambulance down at the site as well. One of the public's concerns was, you know, being able to get responding vehicles into
Correct.
That area because
that.
Of the traffic. So in order to ease those concerns, we made sure that we have apparatus down there, which we will also have for the cooling towers. So we're there to respond to any calls that are down in that Point area. We did not have any emergency calls during the falling of the chimneys, which is good. It was quick. Again, you know, maybe 10 minutes after, 15 minutes after, we received the all clear from a demolition company. They just go in after and confirm that, you know, there's no live Right. explosives that didn't detonate. Mm-hmm. So once they do that, they give the all clear. The traffic was able to be reopened within, you know, 20 minutes or so, and try to minimize the impact on the residents and the businesses as well. You know, we're very conscious of that, but priority is public safety.
Absolutely, absolutely. And there's another example of, you know, the concern for our citizens. They had a briefing. I don't know, recall if it was the high school or if it was the middle school, north. One of the schools, they had a briefing. They being the CDC, they sent their representatives. I believe I sat right beside you or you were close to me. And they did go over in detail what their plan of action was. And they follow through with everything that was presented at that meeting. And I, as in my other capacity as a selectman, was very happy with the way the entire process unfolded. I know that you said at that briefing, and you did have a response team down there, your command post, everything that you just touched on was there for the folks at the Point. And it was, if anything, thankfully nothing did happen, if anything did happen, you had immediate access, essentially, because the response time from the entrance to the Point or the CDC group to anywhere in the Point is within a minute, if that, that whole entire neighborhood. And you could come and go as you please as an emergency vehicle. I think that lightened the load for those that were concerned in the neighborhood. And I'm sure that the same thing will happen with the implosion of the towers, which will be happening tomorrow. And again, the folks that will be watching this, they'll already be gone. That's another, and I know the police presence there was a good presence as well, directing traffic from the Point down to the affected area. Once you go over 195, that's essentially the Point where it's kind of an isolated section of town. No traffic was allowed to go. I know they put barrels or cones up over the overpass. Police were there. and within the neighborhood of the O'Neill Park area, Jackson, Rice, Briggs, it was very well patrolled, very well covered in the event that something should happen. So hats off to the men and women of your department as well as the police department, public safety in general. I know you as well as our police chief, the top priority is public safety of our folks. And you did a great job, and I'm sure you'll be doing a great job tomorrow.
Yep, you know, we had meeting constantly with all the public safety officials. So our fire and police, Swansea Fire and Police, Mass State Police, Mass DOT. There's really a lot that goes into the traffic management plan for these events. It's not just something, you know, willy-nilly that just have, you know, go block that street. This is all well planned months in advance. We've all cooperated, you know, we work together on a regular basis anyway. But it was just seamless with everybody, including the state police, which, you know, we have a commander that lives in town here. So that helps that, you know, we have a personal
connection, relationship
too, as well as professionals. So that helps. So really, we worked as a great team.
You know, Chief, it's amazing. There's so much planning, and rightly so, that goes into an event like the chimneys and again, the towers, which will be happening tomorrow, for something that lasts all of 8-10 seconds. I don't know how long the towers are going to take to go down, but I'm sure it's going to be seconds, because those chimneys came down in the blink of an eye. And they said that if you blink your eye, you're going to miss it. It's amazing. But the proper planning and coordination is evident in a circumstance like that. And it went seamlessly, as you said. And you know, I'm sure the event that will happen tomorrow will go just as smoothly. And of course, I might as well say it as well. I guess we're going to be in the Guinness Book of World Records for the tallest cooling towers in the U.S. or the world.
No, in the world, according to the demolition company, by 1 foot.
By a foot, so it'll be forever engraved in the Guinness Book of World Records. Well, you know, thank you, Chief, for the time. I know you're a busy guy. Any last thoughts or anything, any last updates or anything you'd like to share before we let you go?
No, I mean, things are going very well here in the fire department. Again, you know, I welcome the public to always come in or reach out to me or whoever. To answer any questions they may have, we're happy to provide information to the public. We want them, again, to understand what we do, why we do it, because there is a reason, and the public may not, they may see something that just doesn't make sense to them. Why does the fire truck go with the rescue? A common, you know.
Yeah, that's a common
question. And once somebody just takes 30 seconds of time to listen for us to explain why, it makes perfect sense. And so we don't want people, you know, relying on social media to learn about what the fire department does and does not do. Because unless you ask me or somebody, another firefighter or deputy chief, you're not going to get the right answer most of the time.
Correct.
So we want you to come to the source.
Well, you heard it, folks. There's an open invitation from our fire chief, Chief Scott Jepson, to come down and check out, as he likes to say, your fire department, your firehouse. If you have any questions or concerns with anything to do with fire-related topics, emergency medical service topics, feel free. You heard him. Open invitation. Come down and talk. Ask for him. Ask for a firefighter, paramedic. Anyone down here would be more than happy to sit down and answer your questions and explain to you why it is they do what they do. So thank you very much, Chief, for your time. And up next, hopefully, we'll have our Deputy Chief, Jamison Barros, speaking with us for a short bit. We are here with firefighter paramedic Steve Preslow, and also with firefighter paramedic Derek Demelo. And they are going to explain to us the new stretcher loading system that is equipped in Rescue 1, which is behind us. Now, the firefighter paramedics that are with us today, this is like their primary duty, so to speak, and they can correct me if I'm wrong. They're assigned to Rescue 1, so they're out on the road quite a bit, and these are the gentlemen that use this new safety loading stretcher, I guess you call it, quite often. So they know the ins and outs and how this thing operates, how you take it out of the piece of apparatus, how you put it in, and they can elaborate on the benefits of this as opposed to the old system that we have in Rescue 2, and that some departments still utilize that aren't fortunate enough to have this new loading system. So I don't know which one of the gentlemen want to take the lead, but I'll let someone start the talking.
All right, so we use a striker loading system. Let's go right to it in the back of the truck. This is a stretcher idea. It has a max capacity of 700 pounds. It's completely electronic. Just push this trigger here. All of a sudden, it'll just load up by itself. It's like a ball bearing. It just rolls right out. Mind you, this is going to have a 700 pound patient on it. Just deploys the legs. Once it stops making the noise, we have a manual release button here. Now we can lower this down to a safe loading height for transporting the patient into the hospital or wherever we're going to the scene.
Okay, let me stop you right there, firefighter. Prior to this device, which looks very easy to operate, very quick, you had the traditional type of stretcher or gurney, I guess you'd call it.
Yes.
Which do you gentlemen prefer?
This makes it a lot easier.
And why is that?
I mean, you start doing a lot of calls, a lot of bigger patients. It makes it less wear and tear on our bodies.
Less big back injuries.
So essentially, this new piece of machinery, so to speak, does all the work for you as far as lifting is concerned, and as far as maneuvering it into the rescue and so forth, right?
Yes. So what else is nice is we have a lot of ranches in town. You can bring the stretcher right in, put the patient right on the stretcher. The patient just gets moved one time, and you get them onto the truck. The load system pretty much does everything by itself. You can do essentially the whole system with one hand.
So now this, you take this out, and obviously it's empty, and you go into your affected area, the house or whatever it may be. So now say that we have somebody in this. Now, how do we put him or her into the rescue?
If they're able to walk on scene or stand up, you would just have them stand. This can go all the way down to the ground, depending on whatever height you are. So if you're able to sit, if not, we have a stand chair that we carry out of the house, and then we just pick you up, sit you on the stretcher, buckle you in, put a blanket on you, bring you right back to the truck. Same thing. Once you're strapped in, lift you all the way back up, and reattach you to the truck, which we can show you.
So there are some circumstances where you cannot bring this into a house?
A lot of second floors, some houses that are a little tighter as far as space goes. If you don't have the right space, you can't get the whole stretcher in there because of the size of it. It does actually retract in. So the back one.
Come on, go pull it.
Yeah, please.
Oh, so it makes it smaller.
You can kind of get it all the time as always.
But it still might be challenging, like you described, to some houses where there may not be enough room.
So that's when we'll bring our stair chair. We'll help them to the stair chair. We can bring them on the tracks right down, get this pretty close to the front door, assist them onto this, whether we pick them up or some people choose to stand up, but they don't want us to pick them up, put them on this, and then we bring them right up to the truck.
So a stair chair is essentially you do all the manual lifting, correct?
If you have straight stairs in town, these have tracks that deploy, and it's kind of like moving a refrigerator or something like that, like those hand trucks.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So it kind of takes the weight off of us as well, and safe for everybody so nobody trips and falls. But sometimes you have those curved staircases, those smaller staircases, and you can't fit. So,
all right, so now patient's on there. Can you show us how you put them in, or her in?
So if you notice, it has these amber flashing lights, which is a safety issue. Pretty much assures that if you watch, they'll change the green. That's how you know the.
Did you get that, Mark?
The stretcher.
The lights that are flashing from yellow to green.
Is now locked in place, and it's safe to lift the patient.
Yeah.
So it'll go over like that. It'll go from amber, and it locks into green.
Okay.
So that's how you know it's safe to attempt to lift the stretcher.
That's it, and you just. Reach on the stretcher back. One-handed, easy. And then this manual fail safes and all this too. If something were to happen on a call, we can still use this as a traditional stretcher.
So let's say if for some reason the battery died or there was an electrical issue, we can actually use it as an older manual stretcher.
Here's a latch right here for the deploying the legs.
Okay.
And then same thing for releasing the stretcher. This manual release fail safe if we're unable to unload the stretcher. But you can do everything right from there.
So, let's say for some reason we was pressing the button and it wouldn't unlock. Just come back here, pull this red lever up, and it slides right out.
Oh, okay. Nice.
Now, you both worked with, obviously, the traditional manual type of stretcher.
Fortunately.
And you're fortunate now to have this device. Obviously, I know what the answer to this question is going to be. This is much more efficient, so to speak.
A game changer.
Yeah. I mean, less wear and tear on the firefighter, paramedic, physically.
Yes.
And it's safer for the patient, would you agree?
For everybody all around. Keeps us safe, keeps you safe.
Now,
gives you more longevity.
Once you have the patient in the truck, or the rescue or the apparatus, I'm just going to refer to it as the truck, and you close the back doors, you see sometimes that you folks stay in a particular spot for a while, not for a while, but for a length of time. Can you explain why that is? Because sometimes I get stopped in town and people are asking me, why does the ambulance just not leave as soon as they put the person in there?
So,
you don't have to get into like details.
Depending on what the patient's complaining of, there's a lot of stuff that we start care, whether it be an EKG, 12 lead, IV, even if you have to give medications, that the hospital is going to already would do if they were in the hospital. So we try to start as much as we can of the hospital care as soon as we can to help our patients. So
like that's the example of sitting in front of the house or the you go to like Planet Fitness and something happens there or something like that.
Yes.
You essentially start working on the patient right there before you start moving.
Well, we start at the bedside, but some testing it's better to do in the truck for privacy reasons for the patient. As far as maybe giving like a nebulizer or giving a medication, it's more controlled than our setting in the back of the truck, doing rechecking EKGs, just doing good patient care in the back of the truck. And it does take a couple extra minutes in the back of the truck, but it's stuff that they're going to do mainly at the hospital,
So you essentially are prepping them to get to the emergency room.
Exactly.
Correct?
That's exactly.
Correct. Is that why sometimes you see, and again, people ask a lot, why does the fire truck go with the ambulance? We've answered that question many, many, many times, so we're not going to dwell on that. But sometimes you see an extra firefighter, paramedic go in the truck, and that's obviously to assist you with whatever may be going on back there, correct?
When you have patients that are sicker than your average patient, sometimes the extra set of hands is nice. There's one person in charge of the call. Sometimes it's nice to be able to have the extra hands to just allow them to do the skills like the IVs, the EKGs and stuff like that, and allow you to focus on what you're seeing with your patient so you can make a decision what's best for your patient.
Gotcha. I know I've, fortunately and unfortunately, have used the Somerset Fire Department on occasion when my wife, who has a variety of issues specifically with asthma and breathing, and the department responded very professional, got her in the back of the ambulance, and then what we just described happened. Sat in front of the house for a while, and obviously that was nebulizer treatment or giving her an IV or whatever it may be, and then off you go. Just wanted to clarify that, and I'm asking you guys because you were out on the road in this thing quite often, I would imagine.
Yep.
You're doing your thing. And we as a town, and I'll speak for the Board of Selectmen as well, appreciate everything that you do every day. I know I say it sometimes ad nauseum at the meetings, but I truly, sincerely mean it. You guys are the best, in my opinion, in the area.
And we appreciate your support too.
And unfortunately, a lot of times, the general public doesn't realize that because positions that you're in, unless you as a citizen need to utilize the service, you're not going to really understand what it is that you do. So I have to go off to you. Anyway, so this is definitely a benefit, correct?
Oh, yes.
Now, who was it a consensus of the department? How did it come to fruition that we got this type of device in the back of our rescue?
I believe it was the chief that made the decision. It was right around when I first got hired here, approximately a year and a half ago. They were, I believe, making the decision to switch to this system. But I believe it was ultimately the chief who decided to get this decision and then went to the town
and
the town.
I'm sure he got feedback from some of the guys like yourselves and people that use this particular piece of apparatus quite often.
I bet you we're the envy of some departments that don't have it, I'm sure.
This is correct.
When they see you pull up to an emergency and they start hearing the ring coming out, they must be like, wow, they got one of those gizmos, so to speak, right? It's a good thing. And again, it benefits the firefighter, paramedic, and also the patient. Because, you know, I'm sure there are times when in the old system you were struggling sometimes to try to get the person in the back of the rescue and make sure that they're not falling off the stretcher, and weather conditions don't help, snow, ice, rain. I'm sure when you pull into a side of an accident where there's someone that needs to be transported, there's a lot more involved too. Traffic, whatever fluids come out of the vehicle, it's yes. like a hazard, so that's a good thing. Well, we want to thank you guys for showing us the, what is the official name of this thing?
Striker Autoload.
I'm just going to call it the automatic stretcher.
Hello again. We are fortunate to have with us today our Deputy Fire Chief, Deputy Jamison Barros. And he was appointed, we were talking before we came on camera, he was appointed almost a year ago, or a little over a year ago, he tells me. And
over,
it just
yeah.
seems like just yesterday that we appointed him as Deputy Fire Chief. And I'm happy that we have the opportunity to speak to him, because I've been meaning to get down here to ask him how he's fitting into his new position. So it should be interesting, because he's been here for a little over a year now, to hear his take on the deputy chief's position. And we'll ask him if it is what he thought it would be, if it's more than he thought it would be. I'll let him do most of the talking. So with me here today is Deputy Chief Jamison Barros. Thank you very much for doing this interview. I
Absolutely.
Know you're not a big interview guy, but you're the second guy in command, so I think it's important. Congratulations. You know, I know I
Thank
said
you.
That to you when we appointed you. I know we picked the right guy with the chief's recommendation. I remember
sure.
way back when you were appointed. And it's good to see that people stay in our department for a long period of time, especially someone like you, and now you're at the rank of Deputy Fire Chief.
Absolutely.
So my general question to you, Deputy, is it what you thought it would be? And I mean, how are you settling into your new position?
Well, I'm settling in nicely. To answer your question, yeah, it's pretty much what I thought it would be. There are some unknowns. There's always a learning curve. I expected that. You know, I've adjusted nicely. The outgoing Deputy Chief, Paul Paquette, did a great job of setting a foundation. You know, of course, when you come into a new position, you kind of put your own stamp on things. You make mm-hmm. changes that suit your personality or the way that you want a system to run, but the foundation was there. He did a great job with the foundation, and I was able to pick up and just move forward with things.
So now, what does the Deputy Chief's job? So I guess I'm going to ask you is, what's a day like in the shoes of the Deputy Fire Chief?
Well, here at the Somerset Fire Department, it's a little unique. We're a smaller department, so I kind of cover a lot of bases. I do a lot of code enforcement. Obviously, I do some personnel stuff. I get out with the guys. I do training here and there. I do inspections. So I'm all over the place. You know, I cover a lot of bases on a day-to-day. So with some of the inspections, 26F inspections, anytime there's a sale or transfer of a home, for example, they need a certificate showing that their smoke detectors are all
functioning.
In the right places, functioning the right type. So that's one example of an inspection that I would do. Anytime there's, you know, an oil tank installed in a home, an LP tank installed in a home, these are inspections that I go out on. If there's going to be a tank removed from the ground, I'll go out during the process and make sure that they're doing what they're supposed to be doing, and there's no contamination in the ground, all the piping comes out, all the permits are in place, things like that.
Now, do you do inspections with the commercial businesses in town to say, like, I don't know, if the sprinkler systems are functioning correctly
yeah.
and so forth?
Yep, so I have an annual schedule with inspections. By fire code, some are mandated inspections that we have to do. In town, I try to get as close to 100% as possible. It's something that I've built out over the past year and will continue to build on. So to give you an example, hotels, their quarterly inspections, they have to be done. They're mandated. Nursing homes in town, quarterly inspections. They have to be done. We do our restaurants. I partner up with the building official, Paul Boucher, and we get out on inspections together. And then there are some that aren't mandated, some of the smaller shops in town, but I get out anyhow and I inspect them as well. So there are some businesses that I haven't reached yet, but I'll continue to build out to those, add them to my annual calendar, and reach as many as we can.
Now, you mentioned hotels, and that just made me think of the new hotel that's going to be constructed here in town on Route 6 across from the Home Depot.
Yep.
Are you involved along with the building inspector with that whole process?
Yeah.
I'm talking as from a firefighter, from
absolutely.
A deputy chief's
yes.
position.
Absolutely, absolutely. So the fire code and the building code, they're somewhat independent, but they overlap. It gets a little confusing. So the building code falls under the fire department's purview in conjunction with the fire department. So the plans come across my desk, I review certain things. That code will speak to, you know, fire hydrant location, the sprinkler system, all that stuff kind of falls under there. So we do a comprehensive plan review on that. So yes.
So essentially the, I guess the designer or the architect of that particular, and again, we're gonna use the new hotel because that's the newest model that's going in. Those plans go across your desk and they essentially need your green light in regard to that aspect of it.
Yep, and I work pretty closely with the building official. So, you know, to give you an example, where they're breaking ground, you know, we're talking about fire department access. It's one of the things I've been talking with the engineers about. I look at their preliminary plan, make sure our trucks can get in there, the fire lanes. We're talking about where the hydrants are going to be located. You know, our response, we respond with ladder one and engine five at a minimum of five can be. So things have to be laid out appropriately, you know. So that's one of the things I'll work closely with them before they break ground on it, you know. And then the next thing is all the curb cuts. Will our trucks be able to make the swings? Will we have the clearances? They're going to have an awning. Will they have the appropriate height, you know? So this is all things that have to be submitted to the office by, you know, a designer, an architect, and reviewed and approved. And
now,
then
in a construction such as that, do you look for the ability of your apparatus to be able to go completely around the site, or is it, I don't know what the fire code is, I'm just asking.
Yeah, so we're looking for fire department access roads. Like, for example, they need a width of at least 20 feet. They need a vertical height of at least 13 feet, 6 inches, you know, for our trucks to get underneath. And those margins can be increased if need be based on our apparatus. So that's why they'll have to submit a plan to us. It's like a computer generated model. The new code is, you know, we can't use what's called an opposing lane of travel. So when our truck comes out, it doesn't breach into the other lane. So these are things that we're looking for, and we kind of hold them to, you know, if we need them to soften up the curbs or widen things up for our trucks, you know.
So not now, there are going to be, I think, two additional buildings with the hotel. So I'm sure that you're reviewing all the other plans associated with those
buildings.
That's correct.
So the most recent set of plans that I've seen is the hotel, one restaurant, and two separate buildings. The purpose is yet to be determined. So I'm laying out the hydrants right now for those locations to suit whatever they put in there.
Correct.
And then once I get the actual plan submittal for that building, then I'll start to scrutinize the plan for the building.
I understand. Very good. So it sounds like the deputy chief is a busy position. I mean, I need to ask you one other question before I go to another topic.
Sure.
So could you explain to me, and not only me, but those that may be watching, what was it like for you the first time the chief went on vacation and you were filling in for him? So essentially you were the chief.
Yep.
What was that like for you? I mean, I'm sure you've never experienced, and here you are. I know you went through the ranks and you were supervisor of a certain amount of people, but now your responsibility is the entire fire department. Yeah. What was that like for you? Was it a little overwhelming? Was it?
It's just another step, you know, and I'll tip my cap to our captains and our lieutenants. You know, after hours, these guys they're in charge for the initial incident, whatever it is. You know, they're running the incident. And this is, when you come up through the ranks here, that's what you do, you know? So initially, it's no different. You know, I'm just coming in a little after or during the day at the same time. So it's something we kind of progress up
to. So you kind of, you know, are getting ready for that particular spot. Specifically the position that you're in, obviously, because so if something happens, obviously you would get called whatever day, whatever time of day or night. You would, if you were at home after hours, respond to that particular incident, and then you are the person in charge, correct? Is that how that works?
Correct, yep.
And then it would be your responsibility as, I guess you call it, on-site commander or on-scene?
Yeah, incident commander. So, you know, like I said, our shift commanders would be, if it were after hours, would be the initial incident commander for anything that's going on. And unless it's a big event, you know, they're going to run it. They're more than capable of handling, you know,
incidents. I say it all the time.
Absolutely.
We have the best.
That's right.
Now, switch the topics.
Sure.
Real briefly, we spoke to the chief about the upcoming implosion of the giant cooling towers, but we really didn't get into much detail because when this airs, they're going to be gone.
Yeah.
And people are going to be like, well, what are they talking about that for?
Absolutely.
My question to him was the stacks that were imploded at the beginning of this month, end of last month.
Yep.
He had mentioned that it was flawless in the entire event and how it was conducted. He also mentioned that the deputy chief had a lot to do with meetings. Could you elaborate on what your role was was in that particular type of event?
First of all, it was a pleasure to work with CDI, Controlled Demolition. They did a great job. They're a fantastic outfit. So from my perspective, I dealt with the permitting, the planning process. So there's a couple of things. There's a lot of folks that have skin in the game depending on what they're going to do. So let's just start with the explosives. How are they going to storm? Where are they going to storm? Are they coming from in-state or out-of-state? That changes a lot of the permitting, right? So, you know, I had to follow up with that, make sure they were compliant. Then where are they going to storm? And there's a lot of different tiers. They have what's called a Class 3 magazine. Their trucks are built and approved through ATF that way. So that kind of changed some things. So these are all the details that I'm looking at. Then with the actual felling of the towers and the chimneys, you know, they need to submit a blast plan that I have to look at this blast plan and scrutinize. They need to do a survey prior to and submit that. So there's a third company that does that. And they're looking at things like air overpressure, all kind of things. They use previous blasts as an example. Anything, they'll take manufacturer's recommendations, like for the insulators that are on the wires around there, and how will the felling of the chimneys and the towers impact any structures. Over there, obviously, we have a switching station that's within 460 feet from the base of the towers. So how is that going to affect their equipment? So there's all this stuff that I kind of look at. Are they certified? The blaster's license, all this stuff has to line up. I review all of it, make sure it's in order, which it is. And then I choose to issue the permit the morning of, just to make sure that the blaster that's signing off is the same guy that I have the credentials for, and there's no hiccups or changes and everything's smooth. So I'll issue that permit probably an hour before the blast.
So without that permit, nothing happens?
No.
Interesting.
But again, this company is, they've been in business a long time. All of my dealings with them have been very easy, which is, you know, I appreciate it greatly.
Which is tremendous.
They're a top-notch business, absolutely.
So your take on the felling of the chimney stack, seamless, flawless?
Yeah.
Same, you kind of agree with the fire chief?
Yep, absolutely. From the permitting side of things, the logistical side of things, the things that were under my purview, it went very smoothly.
You don't anticipate any issues with the cooling towers, then?
The actual felling, no. So, I mean, there are things that I'm not focused on. You know, law enforcement's worrying about road closures, and that's under their business.
Right.
But as far as felling, I feel confident that it'll go.
Because essentially, from what I understand, it's the same demo company that's going to be doing the cooling towers as well.
Absolutely.
I mean, I know I don't want to spend a lot of time on the cooling towers, but it's drawing a lot of attention. Every time you turn the news on, especially today, seeing that the towers are going to be felled tomorrow, it's everywhere. Everywhere you turn, they're talking about Somerset, the tallest towers in the Guinness Book of World Records. Yeah. It just goes on and on and on. So
it's not something you see every day, and it's going to change the skyline.
It's going to go back to what it used to be before those monstrosities were up. And I'm sure our neighbors in Swansea are going to be very, very happy that those massive things are going as well. Well, I appreciate the time that we took out of your busy day, because it sounds like you do have a busy day as Deputy Fire Chief. And I'm going to give you the same opportunity that I gave our Fire Chief. Do you have any last minute words that you want to say to the public? I know the Chief said that the firehouse is open to anyone at any time. Come on in and ask us any questions. Do you have anything that you'd like to add to that? Or
no, I'll just echo that. If anyone has any questions of me for code compliance or, you know, smoke detectors, whatever it is, feel free to give me a call. Come on in. You know, happy to talk.
Now, you mentioned smoke detectors. One last thing. Do you folks at the fire department still have that program where you can go in and install smoke detectors for zero?
Yes.
And
yes.
What does the general public have to do? Just call and make an appointment?
Yep, call and make an appointment. It's for the elders in our community, first of all, not just for anyone. Yep. It's they just call, they make an appointment. The guys will come down, smoke detectors, CO detectors, free of charge. They'll do a safety inspection on the home, obviously non-punitive, just to make recommendations.
Correct.
If the guys see a loose rail or something like that that needs to be tightened up. Yeah, absolutely. Just call and make an appointment.
Awesome. And there you have it, folks. Thank our Deputy Fire Chief, Jamison Barros, for his time today. We'll let him get back to work because I know he has probably an inspection to do or run down to the power plant to look at something to do with the towers. Thank you very much, Deputy.
Welcome.
And we'll be back in a little bit.
We've just received a medical emergency call. We're on 4th Street. As you can see, Rescue and Engine 5 have responded. And if you take a look, Brian can pan over to Rescue 1. The lieutenant and the driver of Engine 5 are getting the equipment that is necessary, the stretcher and the chair device is, to assist the firefighter paramedics while they're inside the residence assessing and assisting the patient. If you also look to our left, Somerset Police have responded, as they usually do to all medical emergencies, and they're usually first on the scene only because they're on the road patrolling the streets of town, as opposed to the fire department where they're in the firehouse waiting to get a call. So we'll see what happens as we wait for any results that may come out of this emergency. To a medical emergency on 4th Street. We cleared 4th Street, and as we were heading back to the fire station, another medical emergency came in on Thelma Avenue. Lieutenant called into dispatch and had Engine 5 respond to Thelma Avenue, and as you can see behind me, Rescue 2 responded from the fire station. Perfect example of the SAFER grant in action. With an additional firefighter, we're able to use two rescues instead of calling mutual aid. Had this been in prior years, Engine 5 would have responded as we did, and we would have to rely on mutual aid from another community. That's not the case, and that's the benefits of the SAFER grant. We'll be right back.
We're going to continue our episode here for Public Safety Day at the Fire Department. As I mentioned with our discussion with the Fire Chief, the Board of Selectmen approved the SAFER grant, which was approved final vote at the town meeting, which allowed us to hire 4 additional firefighter/paramedics. And you've already heard from our Fire Chief the benefit that we've had from the additional manpower added to our fire department. I'm sitting here with one of those firefighter/paramedics, and his name is Derek Demelo. The captain was, Captain Phillips was gracious enough to allow us to interview him for a couple of minutes anyway, to get his idea or to get his take on what it's like to work in the Somerset Fire Department, being the new face in the department. Now we appointed them, the board appointed them, and I'll let him, I don't recall the date exactly, but not that long ago. And from what I understand from the chief, deputy chief, and the captain, he's actually feet to the pavement, on rescue, out on all kinds of calls. He's worked for a private ambulance company in the past, and we'll get his take on what the differences are working for a private ambulance company as opposed to working for the town of Somerset on rescue, which gets a bulk of our calls. So I'd like to thank you for coming here and sharing some of your thoughts with us. Congratulations on your recent appointment.
Thank you.
I was part of the Board of Selectmen that did appoint you and the 3 other gentlemen that are here with us in the Fire Department through the SAFER grant.
Thank you for that.
So I would like to ask you, what do you think is the big difference between working for a private ambulance company as opposed to now working for a municipality where you're on rescue, I imagine, being the junior guy quite a bit, right?
Yeah, we're primarily on the rescue one. Main difference, it all comes down to patient care. That's always the same between both private sector and municipality. Here, obviously, it's more 911 emergent care, opposed to doing some transitional care between in facilities and private sector. So you get to do more transitional between like local hospitals to trauma centers and stuff like that. You do like vented patients. Different kind of responsibility here, just more of emergent 911 type care.
Now, when you hear the tones go off or the bells, I can't recall what we have here. I think it's tones. And you know, obviously, you know the specific tone for the specific type of emergency. And you're on the rescue, heading out to your call. What's going through your mind when you, obviously, you kind of get an idea from dispatch what you're going to, but how are you preparing yourself to before you even get to that call?
Honestly, I think it just becomes muscle memory to me. I've been doing it for about 10 years. Sometimes if we'll talk about it amongst ourselves because we're both paramedics, and we'll just throw things off each other. What are you going to be? What's your responsibilities? What I'll take care of, and we kind of go from there once we get on scene. And sometimes it's not even what they call you for, and you got to change it up on the fly.
Right. Quick on your feet, I imagine, right?
You have to be even at 3 a.m. sometimes.
Now, it's kind of off the topic, but who decides who's going to drive and who's going to work in the back? How does that work?
We usually go a call for call rotation. Like I usually go first when I work with Steve, and then.
First meaning what, drive?
No, I'll tech the call, which I'm responsible for the patient, and then I'll do that report, get to the hospital, and then the next call, I'll drive, he'll tech.
As part of the SAFER grant, when you were appointed, you have to go through the full-time firefighter training academy. And I understand that you've gone through what's called, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, the on-call or call firefighter academy. I'm sure they're very similar, but do you anticipate some things being different at the full-time academy as opposed to what you've been through already?
I think they're just going to go more in depth from what we did initially and more repetitive of the training that we did. It's going to be more constant because I think as the call academy, I believe we did like 2 nights a week and then usually the 8-hour day on Saturday for 6 months. So it ends up being, I don't know how the hours works out, but now this will be 8-hour days, 5 days a week for 10 weeks.
Yeah, more of an intense program.
Yeah, they might be able to focus on certain tasks.
Where was the Call Fire Academy held?
I went to the one in Fall River. It was the Call Volunteer Academy. held by the Mass Academy.
So you essentially are a trained firefighter, but at a different level?
I was on a call department for about 10 years before, prior to this.
All right, so you're kind of like ready to go all the way around.
A little bit.
Well, obviously you made a mark already because you respond to rescues at times, one right after another. I'm sure some days are busier than others. All depends on what's going on.
Yes.
Do you have any idea of when you will be starting the full-time firefighter? If you don't, that's fine. I'm just...
Last I was told was June 20th.
June 20th. I know. I mean, I bring this up every once in a while only because I'll never forget it. I was at the Fall River Firefighting Academy along with my colleagues on the Board of Selectmen, our town administrator, for a day event where we actually put the turnout gear on and kind of like assume the role of a firefighter, so to speak. And it's something I'll never forget. And I can't imagine doing that as a job. I mean, for all the firefighters and firefighter paramedics that I've spoken to have said it's not a job, it's like my way of life. Is that true?
Just started here 6 months ago. Definitely have to like what you do, even whether it's fire or rescue.
Yeah, it's not an easy job. I mean, you know, you look at some of the horrific incidents that have taken place across our country. I mean, you could respond to something like that, even here in the small town of Somerset or the city across the river for mutual aid. One never knows, so.
No, never know what you're gonna get.
You never know. So I'm very happy that you're on board. I hear that you're doing good stuff. Can't tell you from who, but I hear that you're doing good stuff. And it's funny because I remember at your appointment, your brother was there, who's also a Somerset firefighter paramedic. Yep. And you told me that you were the better of the two.
You can't quote me on that.
Oh, okay, I won't quote you on that. Is it true that you speak another language?
Maybe.
You do.
Yes, Portuguese.
You do. You want to say, can you say something in the camera to our Portuguese-speaking folks out there that may be watching?
What would you like me to say?
You say whatever you want. Hello, thank you for allowing me to work for the Somerset Fire Department. I don't know. It's nice. I'm only saying that, and I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I'm sure that when you respond to some houses or you respond to some incidents and people say speak Portuguese and they speak broken English, they feel more comfortable, I'm sure, conversing in their native language.
They
and
do.
If you have to do that, I'm sure it's a great ease on them, especially a family member who may be watching a loved one go through some type of situation.
Yeah, I mean, definitely it calms their nerves.
Right, and you know, I think that's a great, that's
anxiety,
a plus.
That they can't speak with you and communicate with you, and sometimes family's not on scene yet, and they'll call the family.
Now, are you fluent in Portuguese?
I'm decent. I can't teach a Portuguese class,
but I
grew up with Portuguese grandparents and all that, and I initially spoke better then, but once they passed, you don't use it as much until I started working in this line of work.
Okay, this is what we'll do. I want to thank firefighter paramedic Derek Demelo for joining us. And I don't want to keep him too long. I'm sure he has duties to do in the firehouse because he is like the junior guy, seeing that he's been recently appointed. But I would like you to look at the camera and say to everyone, thank you, have a great day, in Portuguese.
Obrigado, então, bom dia.